Here we go. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the first in the Champinefu Webinar Series, Shawala, Birthplace of William Hartless. We are so happy that you are joining us today for this video. My name is Bonnie Brzoski. I'm a public services librarian here at the Corvallis-Benton County Public Library. Unfortunately, we had a technical issue that prevented us from recording this event on the original date that it happened. So we've come together today to re-record in an effort to make this wonderful presentation available to more people. This recording is going to be emailed out to all who registered for the original event. It'll also be posted to the library's YouTube channel after it is captioned by staff. Before we get to our main presentation today, I want to introduce Dave Eckert, who's going to introduce the Champinefu series and its co-sponsors, as well as our presenters today. Dave is part of the Mary's Peak Group of the Sierra Club, and he helped coordinate this event series. Welcome, Dave.
Well, thank you, Bonnie. This is quite an honor, and it's an honor for the Mary's Peak Group of the Sierra Club, and it's a honor for me to be able to have worked with the Confederated Tribes of the Grand Ronde for the past 6 years on this Champinefu webinar series, initially a lecture series. And it's an honor now to work with the library and I'll go through the co-sponsors with you right now, if I can bring up my, okay. So I hope you can all see this. Bonnie, can you see that?
I'm not seeing your screen yet.
Okay, I didn't do something then. Hold on just a second. Okay. Let's see if this works. And how are we doing?
Looks good.
Okay. So the theme of this series is Kalapuya placekeeping. And please keep in mind that all themes, subjects of presentations, and the speakers have been chosen by the Confederated Tribes of the Grand Ronde. The Mary's Peak Group, the Sierra Club, and the other co-sponsors are assisting in the administration of the webinar. So the main sponsors are Confederated Tribes of the Grand Ronde, co-sponsors the Mary's Peak Group of the Sierra Club, the Spring Creek Project at Oregon State University, the Corvallis Sustainability Coalition, and the Corvallis-Benton County Public Library, which is the host, the technical host of the webinar. And with Kalapuya placekeeping, we're focusing on Shawala. Shawala is a flower. Shawala is a place. And as a place for this whole theme of three webinars, we're putting a little bit of a focus on the confluence of the Willamette and the Marys River, because that is such an important place, and a person, which you will find out more about from our presenter, Jedd Schrock. So before we get going, I want to just show some photos of the confluence of the Marys and the Willamette River at a place called Shawala Point. And the photos I'll be showing you are by Jim Stratton and Jeremy Monroe. And then we'll have a few historical pictures from the Benton Historical Society and the OSU archives. So here we are at the confluence. And you can see where my cursor is the Marys River coming in. Here's the Willamette. And now we'll just show you, gives you a context where downtown Corvallis is, where South Corvallis is, how the Willamette River is coming up from Eugene and going to the right toward Portland, and where the Marys River comes in at a direct opposite from the Willamette River. And here's Shawala Point right here, which many of you know. Here's another view taken from the river, the upriver. And look, you can see these two areas here. And when we put that in, you can see where the Marys River comes up with Marys Peak in the background. And you can see where the Willamette goes down, and you can see the context right here from South Corvallis to downtown Corvallis to Orleans Natural Area. Now let's look at this aerial view and see if you can recognize any of these places, get your context, and I'll give them to you right now. So the Marys River coming in, the Willamette River going out here. There's the confluence on Shawala Point. It's owned by the city of Corvallis. Mill Race coming in from South Corvallis. South Corvallis is right, starting right here. And land here is owned by the city of Corvallis also. Down here it starts, it's by Hollingsworth and Voss. And now for a historical picture. Here's the way the river looked in 1936, the first good aerial we've had. And you can see the Willamette River coming up, and we'll give you a context now that the river looks kind of interesting here. This is the river here, but you can see this oxbow right here. And I'm not gonna go into the history other than that was part of the river, and it was becoming more and more part of the river. And this confluence would have changed if the river had been allowed to do its natural thing of cutting across here. And so you can see where Shawala Point is, the Marys River now coming in here, and this is and the Willamette River going out South Corvallis downtown. And so confluence sites move. This is one part of change in confluences. They do move over time. We seem to think that everything is fixed. Now, here is a close-up of that. So if I go back, you can see where Shawala Point is. Now, look right there, and you can see it's blurry because of the low resolution of the photo I got, but you can still see the Willamette and the Marys, and here's Shawala Point, but look, it's not like it is now. That's the Corvallis Lumber Company that was there in 1936 on Shawala Point. Again, I wanted to show you change happens. And this will be shocking to many of you who go to Shawala Point now, because that's what it looked like in 1936, totally industrialized. Completely, it does not look like that, does not act like that. Here's a dam right across here, many breaks right here. And of course, look at the black smoke. So, a lot of times people think change is always bad. Well, sometimes it's good, considering what we have now is better than what we had in 1936, 1940. And you can see now the context. There's pictures of both sides. The Corvallis Lumber Company actually owned both sides of the river at that time, of the Marys River at that time. And there's the dam right there. And there's another picture of the intensity of it. Now, another way that confluences change is in their size, but a confluence is a confluence. So look at this from the 1964 flood, which was bigger than the 1996 flood that people nowadays talk about, but the 1964 was far larger more greatly represented the 100-year storm that people talk about. But look at the extent here, and I'll give you a context. The Willamette River comes around out this way, Marys River comes down this way, there's Shawala Point. Here's 99 in South Corvallis, and see if you can recognize anything, which is, this again, 1936 photo, so it's hard to really recognize, but I'll give you a context in a minute. I'm going to give you a couple close-ups of this, but the confluence expands and it contracts. So the confluence is not one size meets all. So think of, and so we're going to see how far this confluence truly is, not just at Shawala Point. So here's Shawala Point in a flood, and the whole area is submerged. There is now a 34 overpass going over this area, but that it really went well into downtown. Shawala Point, and here's where the first alternative natural foods co-op is. Oh, it's not there then, but it is now. And it goes quite a ways south, the confluence. And so right here, this is formerly budgeted in now 3rd Street Commons, Avery Avenue's up here. This is the Pacific Power station, substation down here, Bridgeway Avenue down here, and it goes down to Lilly. So this is all still part of the confluence. It's seasonally based, and it's also over periods of years based. So I just want to change our thinking of what a confluence of rivers is. It has changed. But back to the Kalapuya placekeeping. We have three presentations over 3 months. This is the first one. And then the second one, which is on November 9th, talks about the Kalapuya seasonal round. And on December 7th is placekeeping in Corvallis in Oregon, what is occurring right now. To register, you can contact me at deckard@willamettewatershed.com, and I can send you the link to the library registration. Or maybe, I don't know if, no, I don't think on a recording that this can get on the chat. So I would like to introduce my good friend, David Harrelson, who is the Cultural Resources Manager and a Kalapuya member of the Confederated Tribes of the Grand Ronde. And David has been really instrumental in this whole series and makes sure that it happens and selects everything that you see here and watch and everything. So David Harrelson, take it away. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Dave. A heartfelt thank you to Dave for being a collaborator on these efforts over the last 6 years, and also to the sponsors of the program. Really appreciate the relationship and the fellowship that it's built over time, even as we've moved into the digital world, and very grateful to the library for hosting this and making it the reach that it is and that can provide beyond just an in-person event. One thing that I guess I wanted to say a few remarks is that we sit down every year and we talk about what would be helpful or what would be useful or what's going on that could be shared within the Corvallis community or more broadly of interest here in Western Oregon. And there's a word that's come up a lot lately called placekeeping. And I'm sure many of you aren't familiar with that term. Placekeeping is kind of originates from the field of urban planning, where people use the term placemaking. And some of you have probably heard that more. It's more about intentional investment in communities and other aspects. In some cases, that can create unintended consequences or benefits even, depending on what that looks like. It could mean gentrification in neighborhoods. It could be displacement of people as placemaking. And so in response to that, people started to put forth the term placekeeping, which is to say that there's some things in our communities that are worth preserving and highlighting and documenting and sharing those things. And that in order for placemaking work to be more equitable, we should think about what's already there and invite those communities that are there to take part in the enhancement and the improvement of their community within the context of place. And so with that came a response from the Indigenous community that said, yes, we really associate with that. We're very connected to many places within our homelands, but we're oftentimes thought of as an afterthought, or, we're still experiencing the effects of, 200 years of our ancestors being displaced from locations. Maybe settlement was the original placemaking. right? And so a response to that could be placekeeping. And as tribes, there's two scholars out of Arizona State University, Wanda Dalla Costa and Selena Martinez, who put forth this term, indigenous placekeeping. And indigenous placekeeping, in a very simple way, prioritizes ecological, historical, and cultural relationships to place while bringing the presence of indigenous histories and futures into focus. I'll read that again. So indigenous placekeeping prioritizes ecological, historical, and cultural relationships to place while bringing the presence of indigenous histories and futures into focus. So that's what we're aiming to do with this series this year. Our first presentation, which you're hearing today, is about Shawala as a person. William Hartless, which you'll get more biographical information, is an important Native individual from this location that's known, that shared information with others. It's also the name of a geographic feature and point in the community of Corvallis that many community members know today. Why I'm happy that we're recording this presentation is I'm able to share information that came about when we did our first presentation, which sometimes you can forget how far or how long you've been in relationship with each other. And the community of Corvallis and different community leaders, the Benton County Historical Society and Judy Junton specifically, have been in relationship with the people of Grand Ronde for a long time. Our elders like Merle Holmes and others worked with Judy, and they've done different work, you know, well before this latest generation of Grand Ronde staff and members are doing their work, to the point where many of us weren't even aware that Grand Ronde people or the citizens of Corvallis actually sought out and sought to name the point Shawala Point. And we just took it as a given that that was the name of the point, but there was actually previously an effort to name that. I think that what's interesting is how it rolled out is local citizens came together and proposed that that park be named that, but they didn't really know that the city was going to go for it until all of a sudden years ago, as it was reported, that they noticed that the park had been named that. So the idea came forward, it was a response, and the park was named for this prominent name of an individual named William Hartless. So when we think about placekeeping, that's a perfect example. Placekeeping isn't new, indigenous placekeeping. In fact, the original naming of this park as Shawala Point, given the name for a prominent Kalapuya man, is an example of historic indigenous placekeeping. And by telling the stories of these places and the indigenous histories that connect them, or the words and the understanding that comes with it, I think that it enriches the lived experience of place, which is common. It's not just helpful for tribal people. I think it's the story of the land, and therefore everyone has a connection to the land that they, you know, walk on, live on, sleep on, live their lives. And to know the stories of the land, once again, ecological, historical, cultural relationships to place, I think has the ability to enrich our knowledge of place, our fellowship and community with one another, and generally collectively make the world a better place. So I'm grateful that we're able to have this talk today. I asked Jedd Schrock, who's a linguist with the tribe, Jedd, if you want to come on screen. I asked Jedd if he would share information as a linguist. He's worked through some and worked with the William Hartless material. And I said, Jedd, can you share some information about William Hartless and talk about maybe some of the linguistic aspects of the work, or just introduce that, you know, this guy's stuff and the words that he said, you know, at one point, are still important or relevant today in their own regard. So Jedd graciously agreed. Jedd has worked for many years with our community. Most prominently and probably accessible was co-editing the book My Life by Louis Kinoyer, which is a publication in Tualatin Kalapuya in English, which is the story of Louis Kinoyer's life. who was a Kalapuya man who lived on the Grand Ronde Reservation, is one of the only autobiographies of a tribal person from the late 1800s. Most of them that exist are biographies, not autobiographies. And Louis Kenoyer told his life. We've had previous presentations about Louis Kenoyer for the series. And Jedd learned a lot of Kalapuya to do that, because in order to do it, we had to translate Kalapuya into English, because there was Kalapuya written down that had never been translated into English, given the collection of materials. So in addition to the good work that he's done with our community, he's a friend. He's a part of our greater community at Grand Ronde. He's really active in supporting our language program, Chinook Wawa, and has been, and is just a real great community member who has appreciation and value in folklore and stories. And with that, I will turn it over to my friend, Jedd.
Well, hi, Umasi. Yeah, I'm happy to be here again and to give this presentation another go. I will share my screen. I'll just get straight to it. Let's see here. So you don't have to see all of it. Yeah, so today we're talking about William Hartless. Again, thank you to all the kind words from everyone up to this. And yeah, I'm grateful to be able to try this again. So today we're gonna talk about William Hartless and about Shawala Point, because Shawala Point is named after William Hartless. And this first slide, I'm saying Marysville, birthplace of William Hartless, just as a reminder that, as David Eckert was saying, things change all the time. And at the point when William Hartless was born, this European settlement was called Marysville. Yeah, so that's why I'm calling it Marysville here. And one thing I always try to keep in mind, or something that always guides me, is epistemology, and my sort of working man's definition of epistemology is, how do we know what we want? How do we know what we know? So you think you know something, but how? So it's a layer of skepticism that's always good to lay over everything. So how do we know what we know about William Hartless? Well, there's written records. And there's also oral history. A lot of things, written records have been given great credence by many people for a long time. Oral history has often been downplayed and devalued throughout history. And I'm glad times are changing now that oral history generally gets more respect by the world in general, because lots of the information we have is good information and it's oral in nature. And this is also important because many indigenous communities did not have writing previously. So if an indigenous community is to have input about itself, we need to accept oral history as something of authority. And also in the same vein is community knowledge, that the community of Grand Ronde, the indigenous community in Western Oregon, can develop its own history, and we need to listen to that. So how do we know what we know? Best evidence about William Hartless is going to come directly from him. So I want to start out with, you know, what do we have from him? And William Hartless was interviewed by a man named Leo Frachtenberg, who was a scholar sent out by the Smithsonian to gather information about Western Oregon languages. And Leo Frachtenberg lived in several different places. Sometimes he lived in Siletz, and sometimes he lived in Portland. And he also worked at Chamawa. So at this point, it looks like Leo Frachtenberg was in Chamawa. And he had William Hartless come work with him there. At this point, William Hartless lived in Grand Ronde. Other of these notebooks has this written. So this is the cover of one of the notebooks that Frachtenberg took down from William Hartless. And he always put on the front of each notebook who is in this notebook and where it was. So they were talking over by Salem at Chemawa. And at this point, William Hartless was living in Grand Ronde. So this was 1913. This was 1913. And William Hartless said he was born in Corvallis. So that's pretty good information straight from him. So he was born in Corvallis, we think 1855, 1856. His father was called Marysville Tom. And again, we'll come back to that. Like, how do we know who he is? But it was clear that his father was from Mary's River, there from Marysville, from Champinefu. And his mother, her name was Paula. And this is kind of funny because her name looks so much like a Euro name, Paula, that her name has been given as Paula over and over. But from the record, it's pretty clear that her name was Paula. You can see the second transcription there, Paula. That's what was in the notebooks, and those apostrophes show glottal stop, so it's Paula, not Paula. But I guess if it's easier to remember her name as Paula, then maybe that's good. Anyway, she was Alsi, and we have that from John Hudson, that William Hartless's mother was Alsi. We also know that she had face markings, which is typical of Southern Oregon coast women, but not the, when I think of face markings, I think of the three lines, but her markings were dots. So I don't know what that means, other than the record shows that his mother did have face markings that were dots. And much of the information we have, or much of the information that I have gathered, is from June Olson's book. Here's a copy of it. Oh, it's not showing up very well. It's called Living in the Great Circle. June Olson was a Grand Ronde elder, worked for many, many, many years doing historical research and genealogical research. And so this book that June published, Living in the Great Circle, contains much of the information that she found. And it's really a great authority of information on Grand Ronde people. And so, this is where I get a lot of my information about William Hartless. So if we go to the written records, how do we sort of recreate who was where, when, and what did what look like when? One thing we know is that the Kalapuya Treaty was signed in 1855. And we know that there was a period of time between when the treaty was signed and Native folks were sent to Grand Ronde. That you know, in 1885, there was no agency at Grand Ronde. There were no buildings built. So there was no place to actually send people. So there was this brief period of time between 1855 and 1856 when people were actually removed to Grand Ronde Reservation, where it is today. And in that interim time, there were several intermediary reserves made, and different groups of people were gathered at different places, sort of like to hold them until they could go to Grand Ronde. Not always the nicest of histories there. But this map is made by David Lewis, who will be our second presenter later on. And David has done a lot of research on these temporary reservations. And I'm just showing this so people realize there was a reservation at Corvallis in between the signing of the treaty and when folks were actually sent to Grand Ronde. And it was actually a very important temporary reservation because there was a a steamboat that ran from Corvallis to Lafayette or Dayton. I'm not exactly sure where it went to, but the idea was they wanted all these different temporary reserves to gather from the southern valley to gather at Corvallis, and they could put everybody on a steamship and boat them up to Dayton and then go the rest of the way by foot. So what do we know about these temporary reservations? Some of the things we know and some of the things we don't know. But Joel Palmer's letters and papers is one place to get information. So here's January 8th, 1856. So this is not a full year after a treaty signing, but I have to request that you will come here over here prepared to go to the Molalla, Saniam, Spores, and Corvallis Indian encampments and inform the chiefs that I have desired to see them at my office. So people have not been removed yet. Joel Palmer, who's the Indian superintendent, is going to talk to the leaders of the Indians, getting them ready to be removed to Grand Ronde. And so the question might come up, where was that temporary reservation at Corvallis? And here's what David Lewis has to say. It remains a mystery of where the tribes were encamped in or near Corvallis. Thomas J. Wright's in-laws owned land near town on a bend of the river. It was common for tribal encampments to be established on the edge of the settler towns. Therefore, this may have been the case in Corvallis. So given what we know about some of the other temporary encampments, where might it be in Corvallis? And then we start looking for names, and David mentioned Thomas Wright, so that's one name. And then here's another bit of information out of the Joel Palmer papers where Nat Lane is named as somebody who was sort of a go-between between the government and the Indians there at the encampment. So this temporary reservation was likely somewhere by property owned by Nat Lane or by Thomas Wright. And Thomas Wright is probably, I'm guessing, maybe the one to look for. But again, we don't really know. But we know there was an encampment there and we know it was important. That encampment, so there were Native folks staying there. Joel Palmer had an underling, somebody who worked for him by the name of John Flett. And as Indians started to move onto these temporary reservations, Joel Palmer wanted to get a census of each of those. He wanted to know how many people were there. So we have these lists, these censuses. John Flett went out and traveled to all these encampments, and he took a census at each encampment. And so this is the census list of the Marysville Indians. And this would have been in 1856, I'm pretty sure, 56 or 55, one of those two. And there are two, so we know that William Hartless's father was named Tom, Mary's River Tom or Marysville Tom. So it would make sense that we would find that Tom on this Marysville census. Well, here's one Tom on the fourth line, Tom number two, chief. And over here in the remarks, we can see long time something that gets crossed out. And above it is written in muddy. So it's likely that there was a Muddy Creek reserve as well, or those band of Indians, the Muddy Creek Kalapuyans. Anyway, this Tom number two was likely from Muddy Creek. So this is likely not William Hartless's father. But if you look down at the bottom, there's Tom number one. And over in the remarks, we have Muddy Band written, but then crossed out, meaning maybe there was some confusion. There's two Toms here. One of them's from Muddy Creek and one of them's from Marysville. And there's nothing written above the Muddy Band. So I'm guessing this guy, Tom number one, this is probably the Marysville Tom that we're looking for. But again, there's no way to be totally certain. So if we look across, there's, you know, how many men in the family, how many women, how many children? There's two children. So if we want to assume, or if we think this is William Hartless's father, Tom number one, and he's listed with two children at Marysville at the temporary reserve, then one of those two kids is very likely William Hartless. And we know they did remove to Grand Ronde eventually. So then I went looking for records from there, and they don't show up on the censuses there at the very early beginning. That doesn't mean they didn't go there. It just means they're not listed on the censuses. And our path of looking for written records is dim there. So in 1885, we do find a muddy Tom. And I'm guessing this is that Tom number two. This is probably not his father. But then in 1888, we get record of William Hartless at Grand Ronde. This is a Grand Ronde census from 1888. So here he's listed as 31. So 88 minus 31 should give us 1857. He was probably born before that. So either this, you know, times of the year can, he was probably born in 1856 is what all this tells me. We don't, as we say, that record is a little bit dim between 1856 and 1888. We don't find him on the written records really anywhere, but we do have all the information, the stories that we have from Leo Frachtenberg, the work he did with Leo Frachtenberg. And from those stories, we know his family lived at Grand Ronde and moved off of Grand Ronde sometimes to do work, and they would go to Salem or they would go to Eugene. So while they did remove to Grand Ronde and they became Grand Ronde Indians, they weren't always there. They moved around also, as did other Grand Ronde people. And that's where we start to get in the oral history and the community knowledge. We just know this because we know that's what people did and what happened to people. So now we're going to get into the name a little bit. So how do we know what we know? Best evidence for William Hartless comes from himself. And this is again from the Frachtenberg notebooks. This page 12 of notebook 69, is a list of clearly Frachtenberg asked the question, you know, give me some names of some Marys River folks. And of course, the first name he gave, and give me their Indian names. And so the first name was his own name, Shawala, Shawala, Shawala. That little hook at the end there shows aspiration. That's a phonological reality in Kalapuyan. Anyway, and he translated that as sunflower seed. So, you know, the best evidence is from him. What does Shawala mean? And it means sunflower seed. Well, sunflower is kind of a loaded word. It's not a loaded word, but it's a family of plants. You know, when we Eurocentric folks think sunflower, we think of those big tall plants with the big, big heads. Well, the sunflower seed, sunflower family has many members. And around here, people call them tarweeds. And there's multiple species of tarweed native to Western Oregon. And in Kalapuyan, generally, tarweeds are referred to as asawal, asawal. And Kalapuyan has roots and prefixes and suffixes and all that good stuff. And so the root is sawal, sawal. So when he gave his name as Shawala, it was a little strange to me because I usually see that nominal prefix. This doesn't look like your typical noun. This looks more like a name. So I was guessing sometimes the ah that comes after a root is a repetition, or it's another marking of that nominal of showing this is a noun. But it also occurred to me that it could be an endearment term, that it shows this is like a name, like little tarweed. And sure enough, in Judy's book, when she was working with Merle Holmes, that was their understanding, is that Shawala meant little tarweed. So I think we're all sort of in agreement there that that is a good assumption. We find sunflower showing up on other words in the Kalapuyan corpus, not just in, well, I mean, we find another word, anmetoka, as sunflower. And again, maybe this is there's different things we can assume from this. You can have multiple words mean one thing, refer to one thing, or you can have different species of a flower. So maybe ametoka is maybe one of the species of tarweeds that we know of, and shawal is a different one. Or it could be that shawal is a specific one and it also means all of them. So there's a lot. We don't, if William Hartless was still alive, we could ask him that question about specificity of these words. But we just do the best we can. But what we do know for sure is that tarweeds were very important. And David Harrelson was nice enough to give me a little brush up on some information about tarweed. So much of this information just comes from David. There are three main species of tarweeds in Western Oregon: Madia elegans, Madia sativa, Madia glomerata. These are the Latin binomials for the species. And the most common one is Madia elegans. And when I think of tarweed, this is what I think of. Here's another Madia glomerata. This is what they look like. Madia sativa. So what's with tarweeds? Tarweeds are very important to the native history of Western Oregon. They were a very important food source for Kalapuyans as well as others. It shows up in all the old stories. When people talk about food, they're always talking about tarweeds. Tarweeds are very high in fat, and when you don't eat out of Kroger supermarkets, and you're constantly fed fat and everything, you need fat in your diet. This is energy for you. This is good. This is good. So you need those fatty foods, and tarweeds have very, very high fat content and also very high protein content. So very healthy food. It grows well in fire-burned landscapes. And as we now know and are knowing more and more just how much the native folks around here used burning to their advantage and to alter the landscape in ways that were beneficial to them and to the landscape itself. Important food mentioned in the Kalapuyan Iconum. So the Iconum are the traditional stories, and I look through these stories a lot, and tarweed comes up as much as anything, as much as camas, I would say, just from a anecdotal impression that I get. Tarweeds are everywhere in stories. And as I was preparing for this talk, I consulted a few people about tarweeds, and the term invasive species came up with everybody, and it's interesting to me that but it came up in the question of, like, why aren't there tarweeds everywhere now? Like, there used to be tarweeds everywhere. And a tarweed spread, if allowed to, tarweeds will spread a lot. They really like the Willamette Valley, especially if you burn. They really, really like disturbed land. So something that has been burned is a great place for them to grow. And what's interesting is the burning process was also the harvesting process. So the tarweed field would be burned to prepare the field for next year, but they would burn before they harvested this year's crop. And so you burn the field, and the plants don't just burn and go away. They sort of turn into these skeletons. And after the fire burns, then you go behind with a seed beater, and you just beat on the plants, and the seeds fall out into your basket as you carry it. And it also kills whatever grasshoppers are there, and your kids generally would follow behind and have all these delicious toasted grasshoppers to pick up and eat. So tarweeds were very important, and still are. Grace Wheeler was consulted at the same time that William Hartless was. She was also a Kalapuyan speaker, also a Grand Ronde woman. And this is one of the stories she told, Coyote Panther and Hoot Owl. And she, in this story, she mentions sunflowers, shotwall, or tarweeds, as I would call them. So just, again, traditional stories and the prevalence of tarweeds in them. So Frachtenberg asked William Hartless, well, what's your name? And the name that William Hartless said was Shawala. Shawala. So that's why I put that one first. That's his Indian name. But John Hudson, the man in front and to the right of William Hudson, William Hartless, this is Abe Hudson. He's one of the Hudson brothers from the Hudson family. And his brother, John Hudson, was also a very important speaker and carrier of Kalapuyan knowledge, who spoke with Melville Jacobs and Frachtenberg, for that matter. We do have John Hudson information from Leo Frachtenberg. Anyway, John Hudson, when asked about, you know, give us some names of some Indians and who are your elders, and one guy he mentioned was Footé. And Footé was the name that John Hudson used for William Hartless. And just being in the community as I am today, I just know that nicknames are very important in Native communities. And John Hudson never referred to him as anything but Footé. We have many more Footés written down than we have Shawalas. So I would guess what that points to is that around Grand Ronde, the nickname for William Hartless was Footé. But we also have from John Hudson that he had a nickname of Skamayo. And I don't know the full history of this, but John Hudson said this was a nickname he got because he got in trouble with an older woman somehow in life. And I don't exactly know what that means, but the yo at the end of this usually is an encodative marker, means become, like is in the act of becoming or has become. That S at the beginning, that's a familial term. That S goes on some family terminology. And gam or game is a grandfather or grandson. In Kalapuyan, you have these inverse relationship words that are the same word that mean different things. So game means grandfather and game means grandson. So becoming grandson is how I would interpret that. But again, that's his name, Skamayo. So really more than that, we don't know. But these are the three names we have for William Hartless. So Shawala Point, it's a good name for Bill Hartless. I call him Bill Hartless. I think I learned that from from Henry Zenk. Henry Zenk calls him Bill Hartless. I think sometimes Leo Frachtenberg calls him Bill Hartless. Anyway, I spend so much time with William Hartless materials. I kind of feel like I know him, and somehow I like calling him Bill Hartless, but that's just me. William Hartless. That was his name. He was from there. We don't know exactly where he was born, but you know, I would guess within 10 miles of this point, he was born and lived as a child. And his name carries that importance of tarweeds to Native culture. So those three things make him such an important person for this place. And so it's very fitting that that point was, his name was chosen for that point. So now I'm going to put on my linguist hat, and I will try to not bore you too much. So why Sawal and not Shawal? Well, it's because of phonology, Kalapuyan phonology. And phonology is just categorization. Really, language is all just categorization. It sort of breaks down to that in one way or another. So here's the human mouth, right? We all have mouths. That's pretty common to humans. And we all speak out of this mouth. And we have a set of sounds that we use called vowels. Vowels are generally open sounds. And consonants are, you do something to your mouth that causes more of a closure or a constricture or a tightening somewhere. That's the difference between vowels and consonants. And you can make about as many vowels in here as you can imagine. There's, you know, how do you cut up this space? The sound of a vowel is determined by where you put your tongue. Your tongue curves a little bit and either goes up in front and it makes an E, or it goes up and to the back and it makes an oo, or it goes and lays flat at the bottom and does more like an ah. Anyway, and then as humans, in language, for it to mean anything, we have to say, this is something. We have to create a map and say, this is different from this. This is different from this. That's categorization. So English, this is the vowel system of somebody who lives in, who would speak Southern British English. It's just it's also to say that English has different vowels depending on your dialect. We don't all share the same vowels. And so linguists have traditionally showed this as points where your tongue goes is what makes the sound change and makes us perceive that this is the vowel you mean. So how many do we have here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So for this person who speaks Southern British English, there's 10 vowels. And in reality, a point, I would say that a point is not a good indication of this. It's more of a cloud. It's more of an average where you put your tongue, because you could modify it a little bit and somebody will still understand that that's what an E, whether you say E or whether you say E, or you, it'll never be exactly the same. So a point, a cloud is better than a point in my mind, how we think about vowels. So here's 10 points, 10 clouds, 10 vowels in English. This is how an English speaker would expect. To an English speaker, this is how the world is carved up. There's 10 vowels. 10 vowels, 10 clouds. Well, in Central Kalapuya, there are 6 clouds. There are 6 vowels. Well, there's actually 12 because there's also length. Length matters in Kalapuyan. But as far as place, there's 6 places. And so to someone who speaks Kalapuyan, the world or human language sounds like this. To an English speaker, it sounds like this. And if you mix them, you can get confusion. You could see there's, you know, this E A up here at the front, the red, this big red circle. You could have 4 English vowels come out and it all would fall within to what a Kalapuyan speaker would be one cloud. That's one category that they would perceive. Anyway, that's how linguists think about vowels. So in Kalapuyan, there's 6, and one of them is ah, and there's short and there's long. There's ah and there's ah. That's vowels. Consonants it's a very similar thing. In Kalapuyan, the first line in the notebooks, they tended to write, or they intentionally wrote phonetically. In other words, they wrote down what they heard. They did not, Frachtenberg did not try to come up with a vowel system or a consonant system. He was writing consonants that he heard and understood. as best as he knew. And what I understand to be one consonant in Kalapuyan, which I show as an S, or I use S to write that down for that one vowel, sometimes come out to Frachtenberg, he writes it down as an S, sometimes as a sh. That's the big funny third one here. Sh. And then he would also write an S with a dot, which was something in between, like a sh, sh, sh. And I'm really guessing that, I mean, it's almost not a guess, it's almost a certainty that to a Kalapuyan speaker, to an English speaker, you have two of them. S is different than sh. To an English speaker, those are two sounds. To a Kalapuyan speaker, anything ranging from s to sh would all be perceived as the same thing and would often likely come out as something in between, which to us is foreign. Like it's either an S or a sh. It's not, you can't go in between. But to a Kalapuyan, I think you can. And I think to a Kalapuyan, the center of how you perceive that thing would be something in between. Sh, sh. So, yeah. And I bring this up just because it's important to study Kalapuyan language. Kalapuyan language informs us about human language. And this sh, sh, sh thing is unusual. It's not, you know, this is the International Phonetic Alphabet. These are the consonants as studied by linguists. So these are sort of the places in the mouth where they've said, you know, all human language falls in here. And this is how we carve it up. You're going to hear something in this. Well, what's interesting is these fricatives. This is a th, this is a s, this is a sh. To a Kalapuyan, these two are together. And I'm sure there are other languages like this. I'm sure this isn't unique to Kalapuyan, but it's unusual. It's unusual. And that's a contribution to our study of human language generally, is that this is a categorization that Kalapuyans made. So this is one example of human language, and it's an important contribution. So linguists, this is interesting. Also in Kalapuyan, we have the voiceless bilabial fricative, which is the f, f, which often got written down as an F. Because to us, English Euro speakers, we have labiodentals. We have the Fs. That's top lip and bottom teeth. F, or no, other way around. Bottom lip, top teeth. F, makes the f. But this is two lips, no tooth in a f, no tooth in a f. This is an unusual sound. It occurs in other languages of the world, but it's not real common. But it's there in Kalapuyan, so it's important that we study Kalapuyan. It contributes greatly to our knowledge of human language generally. So. I'm going to play a little Kalapuyan for you so you can hear what it sounds like. And we were talking about the sa, sh, sh, and then it's actually just a sh. So this is our good friend Coyote. He's all over the stories. This audio is John Hudson. So this is not William Hartless. This is John Hudson speaking Saniam, which is another dialect of Kalapuyan, but, you know, very, very, very close to Mary's River. So what Bill Hartless and John Hudson spoke was very, very, very similar. So in the S's and sh's, no real difference, I would say. Anyway, ashne means coyote. And here's John Hudson saying it.
Ashne. Ashne.
Is that a s or a sh or a sh? Sh. Play it again.
Ashne. Ashne. Ashne.
There's definitely some sh in that one. Here's another one. Now, if you listen to the S on the gus, it's definitely a s. I mean, to me, it's a s sounding thing. But the sh in shne sounds a little different. But more s-y than sh-y here than it was up here.
Ashne.
Uh-huh. And then here's a third example. Yeah. So that's just to, so you get to hear that sh, 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 sh. Now I'm going to talk a little bit about the name of Marysville, of that place. So again, this, the black and white gray image here is from a Frachtenberg field notebook. And clearly Frachtenberg was asking, you know, name some languages, or I think he was asking about place here. Kalapuya family consists of the following. And the first one he gave was Mary's River. And I would, this, I would pronounce Binefel. That A with the two dots over it is an A. Binefel. And the I is the long, the macron over the I makes it a long E. Binefel. Anyway, that's the root. And we know from studying other parts of the corpus that you can do things with that root to make a people and to make a place. If you want to make it the people, then you add an on. On is that nominal prefix. But before a P, the N turns to an M. So on becomes am. Ampinefo. And then if you want to, so that's the people of there, the people of Mary's River, Ampinefo. And then if you take those people and you want to make it the place of them, you add a cha in front of it, cha Ampinefo. And you don't do two A's, those A's go together, Champinefu, Champinefu. So that's how you would say that place, that Indian town was called Champinefu, that village, Champinefu, and the people were called Ampinefu. In the past, I have heard people refer to this as place of the elderberries, and I can't be certain that that's not what this means. I'm a little bit conservative when I try to interpret things. Again, I try to know what I know, and I try to know when I don't know. And there's definitely a level of uncertainty here. So this is a little analysis that I'm doing to maybe help people understand why I might not think that it means place of the elderberry. So we know from John Hudson that Nafo was elderberries. But as you can see here in the middle, this Anafo, the A got written as an A, not as an A. So A and A are different vowels in Kalapuyan. And this is Melville Jacobs was the one who recorded this. And he would have heard the difference between A and A. He got confused sometimes, but so anafo, elderberry. So for it to be an elderberry, I would expect to see an ah in there, but we can see that it's actually an ah. Champinefu. This would be champinefu. Those are very close, and it's very possible that it wasn't heard correctly. So B is like B, or it also means like to put. So it is conceivable to me that it is the place where of the elderberries, where there are elderberries. But I would think not. Another thing is that Pine is a means girl. So I don't really think it means the place of the girls. I would say that it just means Mary's River. Binefel means Mary's River. And I don't know that it breaks down any more than that. It may not, but I can't be certain. And so I'm one to be a little more conservative and just be like, let's call it a place, because we know that that's what that place was called. Marys River, Champinefu. I'll move on here. William Hartless was a great example of a Grand Ronde Indian. And I say this with a smile on my face, just because we know how folks grew up at the reservation, and we know, we just sort of know those people. And the more I dive into William Hartless's history, he's just such a great example of what happened to many people. And he represents a Grand Ronde Indian. It's like, you know it if you see it. if you know it, you know it. And we can characterize that a little bit. So he married a woman named Christine Petit. And we know from community that the Petit family was generally lower Chinookans. And this makes me think that Christine Petit came to Grand Ronde via way of a French Prairie. And French Prairie is basically where Champouic is now. But it's a bigger area. Jervis, Brooks, Pudding River, this whole area, you can see on the map here, I have it circled. French Prairie is very interesting history and very important history to Grand Ronde as a community. It came about because the Hudson's Bay Company dissolved. And so the Hudson's Bay Company was functioning up at Fort Vancouver. And it had all these European or French Canadian, or sometimes even Canadian native Iroquois folks come as employees, men come to work at the Hudson's Bay Company. And they would marry local native women, generally Chinookan women, sometimes Kalapuyan women. And when Fort Vancouver flipped over into United States possession, and the Hudson's Bay Company was no longer functioning there, then these men who basically had a family, they had their wives there with them, they had two choices. They could stick around and try to live here, or they would relocate back to Canada, back east somewhere. And so those who decided to stay, who opted to stay, many of them moved south to French Prairie. So those early families that were this hybrid Euro native family, Euro dad, native mom, they had a good thing going there. Life sounded pretty good for them there. And it was really very much like a Creole culture, half Euro, half native. We have this from Louis Labonte. There are two articles written about Louis Labonte's life that are very interesting. I would recommend those to anybody. And so those families started to move in there in the 1820s, I would say. And that continued on until statehood, so 1850s. And when the reservations, when the treaties were signed and Indians were removed to reservations, that whole period, when more and more Europeans were showing up in the Willamette Valley, but before so many people showed up and before there was treaties and statehood, those families, that Creole culture could thrive and live there. And as more and more Euro folks came in, those families were forced to sort of make a choice. You had to identify either white and just not say you're native, or say you're native and then likely remove to Grand Ronde. And so we have many, many families at Grand Ronde that were old French Prairie families. Very interesting part of Grand Ronde history. And I'll come back to that in a minute. So what is Bill Hartless's ethnolistic contributions? He is our main, he's our only source of information on Marys River dialect, of Champinefu dialect. And in those stories, both the traditional econom stories and also just his anecdotes about living life. We have a great amount of ethnographic information about Kalapuyan culture. And we have those econom, we have the traditional stories. And then this sometimes gets overlooked, and I find this to be one of the more interesting things that he has in his corpus, and that is Petit Jean stories, another European folklore that has been indigenized. So these are stories that Europeans would recognize, but they've been creolized. You can recognize them as those old European stories, but the characters do different things, and the value systems that are present are native value systems, native motifs that you find in those econom, in the traditional stories, makes these Petit Jean stories look like native econom. I mean, they're not econom, but those values and those, that culture is all just steeped in there. It makes them very, very interesting. And this makes us think about Creole languages and Chinookwawa, which is a very central language at Grand Ronde. These Petit Jean stories are interesting, and they help us know about Creole language and coining new stuff. It's always a task to speak about European culture using native terminology, because it doesn't always match up. You don't have words for European material culture in native languages. So how do you talk about European material culture in Kalapuyan? We can study this in Bill Hartless's indigenized Euro folk tales. And this is important to us in the Chinookwawa revitalization community, because we have to do this all the time with Chinookwawa. How do we speak about European material culture in Chinookwawa? We have to come up with new ways to say things for these new ideas that weren't there before. And what we can study the way that William Hartless spoke about Euro material culture in Kalapuyan, we can do the same thing in Chinookwawa. How do we speak about Euro material culture in Chinookwawa? We can try to follow what Shawala did. So here's some examples. I've just been working on a story called The Gambler and the Devil. This is actually an Irish folk tale that is often called Stingy Jack in Euro circles. And William Hartless told this story in Kalapuyan, not in Chinookwawa. But the way he told this story in Kalapuyan can greatly inform us how we could tell this story in Chinookwawa. So for another reality of modern Chinookwawa revitalization is sort of a feeling like maybe some of those European words we can get rid of. Maybe we can find words for them in old languages, or Chinookwawa does have the tradition of coining new meanings out of words you already have. This is a very productive system in Chinookwawa. And to see how William Hartless does this in Kalapuyan can inform us how we do it in Chinookwawa. So for example, in Chinookwawa, we already have a word for devil, and it's liob. And this comes from French. So likely from French Prairie, from one of those Euro dads, would always be talking about diable, right? The devil. But maybe mom, who wasn't a French speaker, diable, liob from diable. You can hear how it's similar, but it has undergone some transformation. Anyway, there are people, you know, there's the feeling now, maybe we don't want to use that because it's a Euro term. What we do have in Chinookwawa is a word for God, and that is sachalitai, which literally means the above head man, or the above important person. But we don't have the opposite. But in this story, the devil is the main one of the main characters. So how does William Hartless refer to the devil in Kalapuyan? Because there's no notion of devil in Kalapuyan culture. In Kalapuyan, he called the devil Uwala Achambek. Uwala Achambek, which literally means the below headman. So this is exactly the same relationship. And he's saying, you know, here's how you say devil in Kalapuyan. So if we wanted to say it a similar way in Chinookwala, very easy. Kikwili Tai, the head man below, or the devil. Just like we have Sahali Tai, we got Kikwili Tai. This is him informing us how we might do this. Another example is boots, just plain old English boots for boots. No boots in Kalapuyan. So what does he say? He says, Upos Dunhetafa. Long his shoes is what that means, or long shoes for boots. And we could do the same thing in Chinookwala. How do you say long shoes in Chinookwala? Oh, Yulskit Ilspa. Yulskit Ilspa. Maybe feels better to people than to just say boots. But we do have boots in as something already existing in Chinookwala. And then another, our third example here is soul. And this is a way for us to carry the value system or a worldview, to have worldview carried through language. So, you know, there's no word for soul in Chinookwala. We don't have the term soul. And soul probably wasn't really there in Kalapuyan, something like it maybe. But in Kalapuyan, he says, Danhopna. Danhopna, my heart, literally means my heart, for my soul. So this idea, and I mean, we know this in Chinookwala that, you know, dum-dum is in Chinookwala for, it literally means heart, but it's also what you think, it's how you feel. And I think William Hartless might be telling us you could also refer to a soul as a dum-dum, Nika dum-dum, my soul. So potential thing to say in Chinookwala. So these are, you know, studying William Hartless's Kalapuyan is very important to those of us revitalizing Chinookwala because it informs us tremendously and gives us lots of things to consider. So that's all I have to say. Hayumasi, umsoe, umsoe. That's thank you in Central Kalapuyan.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Jedd. It's really interesting. I'm really glad that we're going to have this on video to share with everybody. It's just such an interesting presentation. And thank you so much. So thanks everyone for joining us. Thanks for bearing with us with the re-recording. I'm sorry we couldn't capture the original presentation, but thanks again to Jedd, David, and Dave for their time. And we'll see you all at Champinefu Webinar Series number 2. Take care.